You doing today? Tired. How many of you know what this morning was? Like 2 a.m. What happened at 2 a.m. this morning? Huh? It was a time change. We lost an hour of sleep. So I'm going to attribute that to y'all being tired this morning. It's because you didn't get that one extra hour. Yeah. Daylight savings. It happens twice a year. And every year, without fail, I speak on daylight savings every single year, twice a year. So if I'm awake, y'all better be awake. I promise that I won't be boring. I don't know. We'll try. How many of you guys have ever witnessed a miracle? Right? Raise your hand. And I want everyone to, like, look around the room at all these people that have witnessed a miracle of some kind in their life. If you don't know what a miracle is, let me explain it to you. How about finding something valuable that you lost? It's a miracle you found that iPhone before mom and dad found out that you lost it. What about not failing that test? That is a miracle. When you thought for sure it was going to be an F and you got that B, that is a miracle. Getting a good score on those SATs, that's always a miracle. What about disease? Someone conquering a disease. That's a miracle, right? I think I've talked about it a little bit before. My grandfather was diagnosed with cancer about 5 years ago. And I had just moved back home. I had just started really, like, digging into my faith. And I was like, God's done all these good things. Like, I'm really, like, ready to seek him. And then I come home and I had found out my grandpa had cancer. It was getting progressively worse. It had been going on for about a year at this point when my family finally decided to tell me. And I was like, God, how can you be so good but give, like, the most righteous man I know this disease? How many of you have ever been faced with a thought like that, a doubt or something like that in your walk? And it shook me, right? Like, I didn't understand how this man that had led my faith and impacted my faith so much could then be suffering with this horrible disease. And I remember sitting there, and they had kind of, like, sat our family on the floor. And I remember sitting there and just going blank. Like, I'm pretty sure, like, I just blacked out. I don't remember them telling me anything other than, like, I have cancer, and that was all I heard. A couple days later, I talked with my grandpa about it and was like, how are you doing? Like, I was upset, so you must be upset, right? Like, you're the one with the disease. And he was like, I'm fine. I was like, what do you mean you're fine? Like, I'd be pissed. Like, I'd be so mad. How are you okay? And he's like, I have faith. And I was like, what do you mean you have faith? And he's like, I know that I am going to be healed. Like, he was certain, I'm going to be healed. God is going to take care of me. My body is going to be cancer-free. And I said, all right, like, prove me wrong. Like, that was my attitude, right? I grew up with my grandfather being one of the only male figures in my life after my dad had left. And so I was just like, I can't lose you. So I want you to show me that God is bigger than this disease. A couple months later, he went in, they removed all the cancer, and he's been cancer-free for about 4 years now. We can give God, like, a shout of praise. Like, his faith changed me. My grandfather's faith changed me. So no matter what I was going through after that point, I always was faced with, am I going to doubt God or am I going to have faith in him? Faith is stable, but fear is unbalanced. And when we approach situations in an unbalanced way with fear, it takes away the miracles that God is trying to perform in our lives. That was a truly, like, miracle moment for me. And it's where I actually began to recognize God's goodness tangibly in front of me. And I was able to see firsthand what it looked like, what happened when faith took over instead of fear. If there's one thing that you walked away with today, out of everything that we say, out of the worship time, out of your prayer time, I want this to stick with you, that your faith has an impact on the people around you. You could talk to your friends that have gone to a winter camp. How many of us went to winter camp a couple weeks ago? I bet you that you could ask any of them that they've seen God make a radical change in their lives because of this faith that they've stood upon, right? Jesus is where our faith begins, and through him, I'm in awe of miracles. I look back at my life and I start recognizing different pieces that I could only attribute to God's work. My mom had multiple sclerosis and they said that it was fatal. She's healed, didn't have to go undergo surgery at all. My grandfather had cancer and was healed. My other grandparents had multiple bouts with cancer of different types and they were healed. You look back and you see things where God had a hand in your life and you can only say that was God. It wasn't me. There's this story, a particular story in the book of Matthew where we're going to look at today, where Jesus was actually in awe of a man's faith here on earth. How can you say that? Jesus knows everything. Like, why would he be shook about this man's faith? It's the only miracle found in any of the Gospels where we see this incredible response from Jesus. And it wasn't from a religious leader. It wasn't from a disciple. It wasn't from someone that had been following him around. It was from this Roman soldier. And we're going to get into a little bit of why that's so important in a second. But turn with me to Matthew 8. We're going to start in verse 5. Now, Jesus had just come from outside of the city of Capernaum, where he had just given, like, the Sermon on the Mount. Have you ever heard of that? Amazing, like, base our faith on this message. If you haven't, please talk to Pastor Jeremy, Pastor Scott, myself. Like, we would love to go through that with you. But he had just come from giving this, like, massive sermon. And he enters the city and immediately was met by a centurion. Verse 5, it says, when he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed in terrible agony. So before we continue, we need to look at the significance of this scene. This centurion was Roman. Now, I don't know if you all know, but Romans and Jews at the time, like, they weren't friends. They ruled over the Jews. And he had heard about Jesus because, like, word of mouth. He had heard about all the miracles that he was doing in the land. And it says in, I think it's Luke, it says in Luke that he was, like, this religious leader. Or not a religious leader, but he was religious. He had some kind of faith where he knew that the Jewish people were set apart, right? He had this feeling about them that there was something different, like a good different. Have any of you guys had that feeling before? Where you walk into a place and you're like, this feels like God is here. I feel that when I walk into the main sanctuary, like, God is here. I feel that when I walk into the Horton, God is here. I feel that when I walk into the multi for young adults, God is here. And he just knew there was something about this people that was different. But because he was a Roman and because Jesus was a Jew, it was not culturally, like, appropriate for him to be going and seeking out this man. But he knew that there was something different about Jesus. As we all can say, there is something different about Jesus. So he went out and sought him with faith that he could heal his servant. Let's keep going. In verse 7 it says, he said to him, am I to come heal him? And this is where the story actually takes a turn. If it were me and I came to Jesus saying, my husband is sick, please come help me. And then Jesus asked me, should I come heal him? I'd be like, you bet. Like, let's go. Here's directions. Like, see you there. You would do the same thing too, right? Like, if you were face-to-face with Jesus, he's like, well, what do you want me to do? You would tell him what you want him to do, right? Look at how the centurion responds, because it is definitely not what I would have said. In verse 8, it goes on, it says, Lord, the centurion replied, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I, too, am a man under authority, having soldiers under my command. I say to this one, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. The centurion didn't want Jesus to come and lay hands and heal the servant. He knew that Jesus had the authority and the power to just say the word, and he would be healed. He feared the Lord. He knew that there was something about Jesus and that Jesus had the authority that would change their lives. Let's keep going. Verse 10, it says, hearing this, Jesus was amazed and said to those following him, truly I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with so great a faith. I tell you that many come from the east and the west to share the banquet with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of God's kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus told the centurion, go. As you have believed, let it be done for you. And his servant was healed in that very moment. Now, I don't know if you caught that. They didn't go, and he spoke it over him. They were nowhere near the centurion's home. All it took was one word, go, and he was healed. He then turns to his disciples and the crowd that had gathered with him. And in verse 9, it says, truly I tell you, I have not found anyone with so great a faith. He was stunned at this Roman centurion's belief in him. Now, they didn't know each other. They weren't like friends and had a history, so the centurion knew firsthand that Jesus would do something great. He had this raw faith in Jesus. God expects his children to be people of faith. He wants us to look at our circumstances through the eyes of having complete faith in him. We see later in Matthew 17:20, it says, for truly I tell you, if you have the faith a size of a mustard seed, you will tell this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. That is the kind of faith we should have, where we speak with authority and things happen. And that authority has been given to us through Jesus. So I'm going to ask you this morning, how is your faith right now? Are you standing on your faith, knowing that God will always make a way for you and make a way for your circumstances? Or are you sidelining your faith, just hoping that things will work out? Having faith brings change to our situation. And as soon as we add Jesus to the equation, our circumstances begin to change. As soon as we put Jesus into the mix, things happen. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the reality of what is hoped for, the proof of what is not seen. Our faith can't be based on our present circumstances. It must be based on the promises of God. If that's where our faith starts, then we can look into the future with hope, knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is going to come through for us in the end. Is this the kind of faith that you have today? How do we achieve this level of faith? How do we have this faith like the centurion, where he knew that one word from Jesus and things would happen? We have to have a faith that crosses all barriers. One of the things that I observed while reading over this passage is that the centurion was focused on putting attention on one servant. Now, you could imagine, like, in those days, he had servants, like, for everything. And I'm sure he had servants for the servants and, like, backup servants that rotated and had, like, a crazy schedule. But he focused on this one. He traveled to Jesus asking him for healing for the one. Now, a servant was, like, low status. They made less money. They had less value in the society. People like to associate them with the other people of the same status. But this centurion took time to care for his servant. And then secondly, the thing I noticed was that the Roman asked the Jew for help. Like I said, at this time, the Romans were ruling over the Jews, and they never asked for help. They didn't need the Jews' help. It was below them. But this centurion crossed all social, all racial, all ethnic, all societal bounds to come to Jesus. And he was unashamed of the choice that he was making. His choice showed that he was not self-centered, that it wasn't about him and looking good or looking bad because he associated with Jesus. It was completely selfless for the life of his servant. And he took a risk by going to the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. There's no separation of culture or religion or language or status. We are all one, and God wants to see every one of us equal, like the centurion made himself in that moment. And Jesus was amazed at how selfless the centurion's acts were, despite the high cost to those that knew him. How many of you know, as soon as you become a Christian, the stakes get higher when you go back to school? When you're the only one in your friend group, and you're trying to lead a life that's worthy of the Lord, but they are trying to pull you back and pull you back and pull you back. The cost is high, yes, but his grace is worth more than any cost you could be paying in the world. How else do we achieve this faith that makes God marvel at us? Is we have to have a faith that makes us active in God's work. To give you a little bit more context, like I said, he knew something was different about Jesus, right? And actually, he didn't just go find Jesus himself. Initially, he went to the Jewish elders and the leaders, and then they kind of found him and told Jesus what was going on, and then he met with Jesus himself. He didn't just say, "You there, servant, go find Jesus, bring him here." He actively sought him. He took steps to find Jesus. He took steps, and that activated that inkling he knew that Jesus was different. The centurion voluntarily participated in God's work. He didn't just sit on the sidelines going, "Well, you all can do the work for me. Let me know when you found him and when he's healed." He said, "No, how do I find this man? Let me find him. Let me seek him." And then he spoke to Jesus saying, "Just say the word and I know that it will be done." We hear it from Paul and James too, that our faith without works is dead, right? He basically says, "Show me your faith without works and I'll show you mine with works." If you declare faith, you should be participating in God's work. If you declare that you have a faith, you should not be letting other people do the heavy lifting for you. Pastor Jeremy can't read your Bible for you. Pastor Scott can't do your soaps. I can't pray in your place. You have to voluntarily and willingly participate. Did you catch that? And it doesn't have to be this big, like, "I'm leaving behind everything" kind of faith step. It's walking up here when your friends are making fun of you and you drop off that tithe envelope. It's when you're at school and you bring your Bible and you sit alone at lunch to finish your soaps when all your friends are smoking pot back behind the bleachers. You have to be active and you have to participate. And when you do things like that, it shows God that you have a faith that's greater in him, that is greater than what is in the world waiting for you. We have to have a faith that humbles you. How many of you know what pride is? How many of you have struggled with pride? Everyone that had that hand up should probably have their hand up again, because at one point you have struggled with pride. We see it in verse 8 that the centurion didn't think he was worthy of having Jesus come to his home and heal his servant. He literally says, "I am not worthy to have you come under my roof." This shows me that this centurion was a man of amazing humility. He understood who Jesus was, that he had authority, and he understood who he was in the greater scheme of who Jesus is and who we are. He knew that he had worldly power, but he also knew that Jesus had heavenly power. He knew that he had the power to arrest and to punish, but he knew that Jesus had the power to liberate and free everyone. He had the power to arrest and to punish, but he knew that Jesus had the power to love and to cherish. He knew that in a worldly sense, that speaking to Jesus was under his authority. But he also knew that spiritually he was under Jesus' authority. And he counted heavenly power greater and surrendered everything to Jesus in that moment. He humbled himself. He humbled himself. And when we come to God, we have to come to him in humility. We have to put our pride to the side and know that there is someone greater than ourselves. There is a love greater than ours. We see it in James 4:6, but he gives greater grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. In our physical state and in our worldly state, we are unworthy to stand in front of God. But when we come before him humbled and willing to receive all that he has for us in every single way, we're shown this incredible grace that only Jesus can give. And it's in that moment that our faith really begins. I'm going to call up Lily and the band. She's like, why? How else can we have this faith that makes Jesus marvel at us? Is we have to have a faith that trusts in him alone. A faith that trusts in Christ alone. Back in verse 8, he says, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. The centurion recognized the authority that Jesus had over the world, and he knew that his word was enough, and he trusted in Jesus. He wasn't afraid of the outcome. He trusted in Jesus, and he didn't have a plan B if Jesus like turned him down or didn't fulfill what he was asking him. He trusted him wholeheartedly. How many of you have ever said, oh, I'm gonna give Jesus this, but just in case this doesn't work out, I know I can go this way instead. At women's Bible study last week, Pastor Shelley dropped this nugget. And if you know Pastor Shelley, it's like bombs all the time, like just saying things to you. But she said in this Bible study, fear and faith cannot coexist. Fear and faith cannot coexist, because when you start letting fear in, you're actually pushing your faith out. They can't coexist. When you start letting doubt come in, your faith finds a back door. Faith and doubt can't coexist. Faith and fear can't coexist. Faith and pride cannot coexist. Whenever I'm doubting, I give Miss Melody a call. Whenever something has affected my life in a negative way and I'm like, why am I being put through this? Why is God putting me in this situation? Why am I having these doubts about myself and my husband and my ministry? She reminds me from James 1, it says, every good and perfect gift is from above. God isn't giving us the raw hand because he wants to see us suffer. He's wanting to test our faith. And in those moments where I decide that faith is greater than fear, I start to see a change and see those good works that come from above. The fear and doubt and lack of trust we experience here on earth aren't from God. But the centurion knew, he believed that Jesus' word was more than enough to do something supernatural and wonderful in the life of his servant. The centurion could have called a Roman doctor to come and attend to him, but he didn't. He found this Jewish man that he recognized had authority in our world of brokenness. He didn't depend on anyone else but Jesus. I want to leave you this final verse. It says in Romans 15:13, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you believe, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. My question for you this morning is this: who are you trusting? Who are you trusting? Who are you putting your faith in? Do you believe, like that centurion, that Jesus has ultimate power and authority over your life? Sam and I used to lead a house party. How many of you ever were in the nest at one point? Y'all, don't be shy. It was there. How many of you know that we, like, took it a step further and we fed you guys? Like, not like dino nuggets from the oven. Like, we fed you. Like, the good food. Sloppy Joe's, spaghetti, baked mac and cheese. Yeah, Mateo's like, that's right, send a tray. Now, how many of you know, like, buying food is not cheap? Okay. So at this one point in our house parties, we made the foolish decision to feed our house party every single week. And at one point, we had about 17 people in my house. About 10 of them were boys, so then you know it's more like 37 people in my house. But this particular week, we had woken up that morning and we checked that bank account just to make sure we were doing good, and we were down to like our last $40. And I was like, I gotta feed all these kids tonight. Sam, I don't know how we're gonna do this. It's payday is Friday, we got 2 days left. We're doing like frozen Eggo waffles or something. Like, I can't feed them this week. And I felt horrible. And he was like, God's gonna provide. And I was like, yeah. Like, what, he'll send me a meal? Like, DoorDash will come from above? Like, I'm not sure, manna from heaven? Who knows? I was like, you're crazy. How is God gonna provide for these kids that are coming into our home and then provide for us through the rest of the week? And he said, I don't know, Aslan, but he will. Let's pray about it. So we prayed, and I will admittedly tell you the whole time I was like, yo, you're nuts. Like, this is not gonna happen. God, like, prove me wrong. I wanna be proven wrong. I go to work that day, I come home, I go to the grocery store, I picked up everything for dinner that night, and I go check my mailbox, and I take the mail and I go upstairs, junk mail, bill. And I was like, awesome, I'm having money problems already, bill. And I found this one, and it was like labeled from some weird like company, and it was like versus Kate Spade, something weird. I opened it up and it said that while I was working at Kate Spade, they actually had misread my time cards. So I actually was unpaid for X amount of hours. Literally $50 was that check. Everything I had just used on groceries to feed my house party that night, God sent that money to my mailbox. And the same day, I remember calling Sam, like, sitting there staring at this letter in my hand, and I was like, what did you do? Like, what kind of prayer did you pray? Like, how is this possible? And he was like, Aslan, I just knew. I had faith that if we asked for it, Jesus would send it. I have a need. Jesus is going to fill it. And that's what we have today. You have a need. Jesus is going to fill it. Now, it may not be in that form of a $50 check, but it could be in the form of someone taking you to Starbucks, paying for your lunch, taking you to brunch. All my young adults were like, amen. Jesus works, guys. He works for us. He's not against us. But all it takes is us saying, yes, I put my trust in Jesus and in Jesus alone. I'm going to have our adult leaders kind of position yourselves around the room, and we're going to go into a few minutes of prayer before we leave today. What is that thing in your life that you need a little bit more Jesus today? Where your faith is wavering a little bit and you sense that fear and doubt coming in. What is that thing that you need him to come and show you supernaturally how much you mean to him? Over these next few moments, we're going to meet with our small groups and we're going to take this time and pray. And be honest with yourself. What is that thing that is shaking my faith? That song, Fresh Outpouring, I love that song. Thank you, Lily, for appeasing me and doing it for worship today, because she originally told me no. But I love this song because it's literally us asking God for something new and something fresh. And today I want that to be that he's renewing your faith in whatever situation that is. Have faith in God this morning. Look at your circumstances through the eyes of faith. God will do it for you. Let today start a fresh outpouring in your lives. Heavenly Father, we love you. We are so grateful for you this morning, God, and the things that you do in us. I pray that we would be open and surrender those moments of fear, those moments of doubt, and that you would replace them with a faith and a trust in you and your son. Go ahead and find your small group leader. If you don't have a small group, find Pastor Scott or myself or Pastor Jeremy, and we'll help get you to one.